understand me when everything I do is wrong. You give me hope and consolation. You give me strength to carry on. When you smile, the world is brighter. You touch my hand and I'm a king. Your kiss to me is worth a fortune. Your love for me is everything. I guess I'll never know the reason why you love me as you do. That's the wonder, the wonder of you.
That's Excuse me, everyone. Thank you. Yvonne's asked that there are still some seats available down here, and the Lady Chapel, there are some seats available over there as well, if anybody would like to come and sit down. That's Yvonne's request. So please come and fill the pews up and down there. Thank you very much.
As Tony's body enters the church this morning, we'll be singing the hymn, "Here I Am, Lord."
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today, of course, is a very sad and difficult day for you. You've come here together this morning as a family to take part in the funeral rites of Tony, your husband, your father, your son, your brother, your uncle, and your old and dear friend. And even though these are sad occasions, at the same time, they're always occasions of great grace, because we are reminded here in a very powerful way of how quickly the years just fly by, how life itself is a very precious gift from God, and we should try and live that life every day, if we can, to the full. You're probably very conscious of all the good times and happy times you were able to share with Tony. Thank God for them. Maybe a touch of sadness for all the things left unsaid and left undone as there has to be in any human life. But right throughout the scriptures, we are reminded by Christ that for those who are faithful, for those who believe, life is simply changed, not ended. And while we have here the obvious sadness of death, at the same time, looking through the eyes of faith, we have the bright hope and the promise of resurrection, of immortality. So let's use our Mass this morning, first of all, to thank Almighty God for the gift of life he gave to Tony, for all he was able to do and to achieve in that life of his. And just now leave him safe in God's loving hands, until that day when our faith says, you will see him again. And on that day, there'll be no more separations and no more tears. Here now in the presence of God, our loving Father, let's pause for a moment and call to mind our own sins. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us and lead us with our sins forgiven to eternal life. Let us pray. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant Tony, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may now rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Can we sit now for the first reading?
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Though I command languages, both human and angelic, if I speak without love, I am no more than a gong booming or a cymbal clashing. And though I have the power of prophecy to penetrate all mysteries and knowledge, and though I have all the faith necessary to move mountains, if I am without love, I am nothing. Though I should give way to the poor all that I possess, and even give up my body to be burned if I am without love, it will do me no good whatever. Love is always patient and kind. It is never jealous. Love is never boastful or conceited. It is never rude or selfish. It does not take offense and it is not resentful. Love takes no pleasure in other people's sins, but delights in the truth. It is always ready to excuse, to trust, to hope, and to endure whatever comes. Love does not come to an end, but if there are gifts of prophecy, the time will come when they must fail, or the gift of languages, it will not continue forever, and knowledge, for this too, the time will come when it must fail. For our knowledge is imperfect, and our prophesying is imperfect, but once perfection comes, all imperfect things will disappear. When I was a child, I used to talk like a child and think like a child and argue like a child. But now I am a man. All childish things are behind me. Now we are seeing a dim reflection in a mirror, but then we shall be seeing face to face. The knowledge that I have now is imperfect, but then I shall know as fully as I am known. In short, there are three things that last: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. For the psalm, we'll sing together, "The Lord is my shepherd." We stand to greet the gospel. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You place your trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, I would have told you that. I'm going now to prepare a place for you. And after I've gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you with me, so that where I am, you may be too. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the light. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Can we sit now? And Sinead would like to say a few words.
asked some of Tony's friends to share some stories about him to include in this eulogy. The general consensus was that stories about Tony were best saved for the wake and probably not read out in a church. So I'll keep it clean. Tony was born on the 20th of June, 1964, the first son and middle child of Don and Anne O'Mahony. Tony was a very mischievous child, but Anne, my nanny, never thought he did anything wrong. Tony was a golden boy, but most people's golden boys are better behaved. When Tony went into hospital to have, when Nanny went into hospital to have Aidan, Tony's younger brother, my mum Jackie went to stay with family friends, the Munleys, who had four boys. But the only person who would look after Tony was his auntie Mary, who was much stricter and knew how to handle him. Tony, Jackie and Aidan, aka Quentin, a name given to him by Tony, were the best of friends throughout their entire lives. Pretty regularly, Tony would lob something across the garden fence and would smash a pane in their lovely next-door neighbour's conservatory, which led to them fitting a wire mesh over the conservatory, but never telling off Tony. Tony spent his school years telling jokes and having fun, but not really doing any work. So when he left school, his dad, Don, got him a job in a laundry. Tony lasted about a week at the laundry and then left to go and work with Irish Simon, his lifelong friend. Simon and Tony worked selling fruit on Oxford Street and at markets around London. And then at 18, he went to Israel to work on a kibbutz. But he left rather rapidly when he realised he wasn't going to make any money there. So he headed off to Tel Aviv, where he worked in a bar and sold ice lollies on the beach. When Tony returned to London, he went to work selling tickets. Initially outside football grounds and theatres, and eventually building his business to his own ticket agency with his friend Eric. Selling tickets gave Tony the opportunity to travel around the world to the Olympics, World Cups, the Euros, and amazing concerts. Everywhere he went, he would meet new people and made friends all over the world. An example of this was at the Atlanta Olympics in 1996. Tony and a group of fellow secondary ticket agents couldn't find anywhere to stay, as all the hotels were fully booked. They were in a bar, and a man overheard all of them talking and said, "My wife's away. You can all come and stay with me." So they did. And in true Southern hospitality style, their host even brought round a celebrity chef to cook for them all. Tony tried to repay the man's great kindness when his friends were in London, getting them tickets for West End shows, making sure they had a wonderful time. It was whilst he was on holiday in Turkey in 1995, across a crowded karaoke bar, Tony met the love of his life, Yvonne. Yvonne was on holiday with her sister Jackie and friend Jane, and Tony was away with his brother Aidan and friend Paul McAvoy. Yvonne was living in Jersey at the time, and they spent 2 years visiting each other between London and Jersey until Yvonne moved to London in October 1997. They bought a house together in Kenmore Avenue in Kenton. Their first child, George, was born in June 1999, and Tony couldn't have been prouder or happier. Their daughter, Neve, was born 2 years later, in February 2001. Tony and Yvonne got married in Jersey in 2003, surrounded by friends and family. Soon after, Tony and Front Row Promotions got an office in Cleveland Street in Fitzrovia, and Yvonne's friend, Charlie McArdle, who now reads the news in Jersey, went to work for Tony as his PA. Tony was later joined by his protege, Ryan Farden. Ryan was the son of family friends Alan and Maureen, who used to be George's childminder. Tony and Ryan worked together for many years and were the best of friends. I worked with them briefly after university, where I took up the role as Front Row Promotions General Dog's Body and McFlurry Delivery Service. I'll always look back at that time in my career fondly, although much of it was spent getting Ryan and Tony back over from the Georgian Dragon when the phones were going mad. I remember a day when two ticket agents from Israel came into the office. Tony saw this as a fabulous opportunity to dust off his Hebrew. The two Israeli guys told me that Tony's 1970s kibbutzim hippie Hebrew made him sound like Austin Powers. The most important thing to Tony was having fun with friends and family and going on lovely holidays. Tony, Jackie and Aidan were on holiday in the Costa del Sol about 20 years ago, and they were sitting around the dinner table after a day at the pool. Tony said, "Look at the state of me. I'm completely sunburned. This would never have happened if Yvonne was here." They asked why? Because she would have been putting sun cream on me all day. She never would have let me get into this state. Yvonne did everything for Tony, and he adored the ground that she walked on. He'd always just sit there, usually after a few drinks, and say to everyone, just look at her. Isn't she stunning? Yvonne and Tony bought a holiday home in La Manca in 2007 and had been planning to retire there. Another thing Tony absolutely loved was the time he spent with his friends Jeff and Kathy, going to the boxing, living the high life, travelling around on a private jet. Even when Tony lost all the weight and was looking very trim for the first time since the early 90s, he kept the picture of him showing off on the private jet as his profile picture on all his social media. Tony was a wonderful, loving father to George and Neve. He tried his best to be strict with them, but when they would bring their friends back for the afters, Tony would be straight down having a drink and partying with all of them. I don't think Tony really knew what strict was, because he certainly didn't learn it from Nanny. Tony was a devoted son to his mum, my Nanny Anne, and she adored him. She absolutely loved just hanging out with Tony on the sofa. Sandwiched between him and his dog, Charlie, making them both watch The Chase or Nothing to Declare and sharing a lager. In January 2020, Tony went into business with his friend Stuart. Unfortunately, it turned out the beginning of a global lockdown and the cancellation of all events probably wasn't the best time to join a ticket agency business. It was while he was with his friend, The Sheik, which I'm sure you've all heard about, at the World Cup in Qatar in autumn 2022 that Tony started to feel unwell. Tony was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer in January 2023. He had radical surgery and 6 months of chemotherapy. His positive attitude throughout months of being in hospital and being near my mouth for weeks at a time was truly inspirational. In October 2023, he was told he had the all clear and celebrated with a trip to Dubai with Yvonne and Neve. They partied for 10 wonderful days with my sister Orla and her boyfriend Charlie, who lived there. It took Orla and Charlie a month of clean living to recover. When Tony fell ill again, both he and Yvonne really cherished that they had the opportunity to have that holiday when they could. The day before he died, Tony was in his hospital room, holding court with a full day of visitors, getting a haircut and making plans for the future. But things took a turn for the worse the next day and he got very sick very quickly. Tony was in a lot of pain, but hung on until his beloved George could get back from university in Sheffield. As he was dying, my mum Jackie said to him, "What am I going to do without you?" Tony wasn't scared or upset. He was at peace. And he said, "Jack, I've had the most wonderful life." And he really did. But I suppose there's only so much fun one person can have in a lifetime. Tony was the most fun, and I think that's how everyone will remember him and the too short time that we had with him.
We stand now for the bidding prayers.
We thank God for Tony's life and his enduring commitment to all and love for his family and friends.
We pray for all those who cared for our Uncle Tony at Watford General, Royal Free and Mount Vernon Hospital.
We pray that Tony is reunited with his loved ones who have passed, his father Don, his uncles and his father-in-law John.
We are thankful to Tony's courageous, positive and brave attitude in his fight against his illness. He was inspiration to all of those who knew and cared for him.
We pray for Yvonne, George, Neve and family that they will receive strength to assist them in their sadness and grief.
We thank Tony for all the love and kindness he has shown and memories he has left behind.
We make these and all of our prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Can we sit now for the offertory? Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Brothers and sisters, now, that my sacrifice and yours be acceptable to God the Father Almighty. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Tony, we beseech your mercy, that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour may find in him a merciful judge, who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him, the hope of a blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when our earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. So now with the angels and archangels, thrones and dominions, and all the hosts and the powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Can we kneel? You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread. And giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Let's now proclaim together the mystery of our faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be here in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Vincent our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Tony, whom you have called from this world now to yourself. Grant that he, who was united with your son in a death like his, may now also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember all of our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them now into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. Let's now stand and pray for the coming of that kingdom with the words that Christ himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always." Let's now turn towards each other and wish each other the peace of Christ. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world.
Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Thank you. It is now our most solemn duty to carry out in the traditional manner of God's faithful people the committal of this mortal body. As we do so now, we call with great trust upon God, from whom all of creation has life. May he, in due time and by his power, bring to resurrection with all the saints the body of this our brother Tony, which in its frailty we shall soon be. May God unite his soul with those of all the saints and faithful departed. May he be given a merciful judgment, so that redeemed from death, reconciled to the Father, carried in the arms of the Good Shepherd, he may deserve to enter fully into everlasting happiness in the company of the Eternal King, together with all the saints. Saints of God, now come to his aid. Come now to meet him, angels of the Lord, and welcome his soul. Present him to God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, now welcome you. And may the angels bring you into the arms of Abraham. Welcome his soul. Present him to God the Most High. Lord, grant him everlasting rest, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Present him to God the Most High. Grant, O God, that while we lament the departure of this your servant, Tony, we may always remember that we are most certainly to follow him. Give us grace to prepare for that last hour by a good life, that we may not be surprised by a sudden and unprovided death, but be ever watching that when you call, we too may enter into eternal glory through Christ our Lord. May Mary, the most merciful Virgin Mother of God, kindest comforter of those who mourn, commend to her Son the soul of his servant Tony, who has now departed this life, that through her maternal intercession he may soon quickly reach his longed-for home and live there forever and ever. Eternal rest now grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace, and one day rise in glory. Amen.
One more step on the world. when the rain is blowing in your face and the whole world is on your case. I could offer you a warm embrace to make you feel my love. When the evening shadows and the stars appear and there is no one there to dry your tears, I could hold you for a million years to make you feel my love. I know you haven't made your mind up yet, but I would never do you wrong. No doubt in my mind where you belong. I'd go hungry, I'd go black and blue, I'd go crawling down the avenue. No, there's nothing that I wouldn't do to make you feel my love. To make you feel